We're missing a few people, but oh, that's the...
I don't know if we really want that.
There you go.
That's better. Okay, I guess let's get started. People will come in if they can. Try the other door.
Seriously, is it locked?
Yes, I don't know what happened. That needs to be fixed. Oh, there you go. You're stronger than I am. Okay, let's get started. I didn't intend to lecture, but this may be the only lecture that we go over since you've already read a paper. But hopefully this will be more like a discussion. Just a few reminders to begin with. Has everyone sent homework zeros to us? Including the visiting students? Okay, well, you're leaving for your internship anyway, so. But that's okay. And has everyone submitted the main memory scaling reviews? I think everyone has, but I cannot be sure. Anyway, if you would like to submit, you're more than welcome to do so, even if you're not taking the class, even if you're auditing. And I don't think we wait a second. I need to call Yishin, I think. Let me figure this out, because I think he has some. Because he may have some announcements to make also. Okay. Hi, Yishin.
Hi.
All right, we're in class right now.
Okay.
And I was reminded of calling you when I was doing some announcements. Okay, there he is. Okay, let me do this. You're going to be smaller. Okay. Okay, I think there are only 6 people who sent the 3 papers that they wanted to review. Is that true, Yishin? Yeah. Okay, anyway, maybe he'll hear us at some point. But please send me and Yishin your papers. The review for the memory scaling was due yesterday, and the review for these 3 papers are due September 4th, but I'm willing to give an extension. What do you guys think? You want an extension?
Why not?
Because this is, I would like you to cover these in detail, actually. So 3 papers could be a lot, depending on which papers you select. How about we do it for... When is September 4th? September 4th is?
Tomorrow.
It's tomorrow, right?
Yeah.
And tomorrow is Thursday.
Thursday, yeah.
How about we do September 6th then? Is that better for the 3 papers? Okay, let's do September 6th. Okay, Yishin, you're recording that? We don't hear you, but.
Hello?
Hello? Yeah.
Yeah, what's about? And your research.
Okay, so yeah, it'll be due at the same time as you and your research, so that should be okay,
okay.
Right? That's an easy paper to read and review anyway, right? Okay, and if you've taken it, you'll read it. And I'm really flexible, actually. This course is a very advanced course, so if you submit it one day late, that's okay. As long as you submit it before next week, okay? I'd like good reviews. And this is for your own research also, so it's more important for you, in a sense, to submit it. But please send the papers as soon as possible. Pick the 3 ones. You've already read the main memory scaling paper, so please send them right away. And the Hamming talk review is due September 6th also. And I'd really encourage you to think about your projects. as I did last time, I'll still keep encouraging you to do that. The handout will be online soon. Yishin, we should put that up soon. The dates are tentative, but proposal will be due around September 30th. So that should give you enough time. You basically have a month or so to discuss with us. And please discuss with us your proposal before you actually submit the proposal. We have the luxury of having a small class. I think there will be, in the end, maybe 6 to 8 students in the class. We're actually taking it, and maybe 3 people auditing. And people who are auditing, you're more than welcome to give proposals also. And we'll have a lot of opportunity for interaction to give you feedback on your proposal, such that you have a good proposal by September 30th. Is that good? OK. Let's see, this didn't. Oh, wait a second. I had something else somewhere. OK, yeah, think about your projects. I think these are some of the reading and project topic areas that I mentioned in the past lecture. But you don't have to be limited to any of these. But this covers a lot of stuff in computer architecture, really. So I definitely encourage you to think about some of these. Today, we'll talk a little bit more about memory systems. And hopefully, some of you will do research on memory systems in this class. But many of these, plus other things that you may be interested in, we're very open. And the project handouts, project topics that are already on the website actually have some of these and other stuff as well. So hopefully people are thinking about project topics, coming up with that big key idea. OK, let's see. I don't know why this is going so slowly, or not even going. Oh, it's because I switched to Yishin. OK, that's better. And this is just to motivate you. There have been a lot of past projects that have come out of this course that were published at top places. So strive for that. Even if it's not published by the end of the semester, maybe you can make the research bigger later on and have an impact on the field. OK, so now I'd like you to tell me who wants to present next week. Today, it'll be me. I'll talk about memory systems. Maybe we'll overflow to early next week also. But I want 2 presenters for next week, Tuesday and Thursday. And you could actually present the papers you're reviewing. So you're already going to pick 3 papers anyway. You're going to review them by September 6th. And you can do presentations on all 3 if you want. But maybe 2 is good. That way, we can discuss. But I'd like to know this early, such that we can plan ahead, and everybody can look at those papers. I know this is a tough task for the presenter, but who's excited about doing this? Dora? OK, great. Do you want to go with Tom or Dora? OK, Dora. I like calling you Dora. So OK, so you can do Tuesday, Thursday. Doesn't matter?
Thursday,
OK. Who wants to do Tuesday? OK, you want to do Tuesday? That's great. We have 2 presenters for next week. So Yishin, Tuesday, it's Kevin. And Thursday, it's Dora who are presenting. And can you send the papers that you want to present? Do you want to present all 3? That's actually perfectly fine, since you're going to review all of those. Maybe 2? OK, why don't you tell Yishin and me if you CC me? And you'll do 2 also?
I can try 3.
Okay, yeah. Okay, that sounds good. Yeah, so they're going to, Kevin and Dora are going to send you the papers, and we're going to announce them to class such that class, everybody's prepared for discussion. So the way I would like to do this is basically you guys can present the papers, what is similarly to what we discussed. What is the problem? What is the goal of the paper? What are the key ideas of the paper? What are the strengths of the paper and the weaknesses of the paper? What are potential improvements? It's going to be very similar to your review, except it'll be better, hopefully, because it'll be in a presentation format. So you can actually use slides. You can actually use animations to explain the mechanisms, for example. And you're more than welcome to, if the authors actually have made the slides available, you're more than welcome to borrow from them. But I don't want you to present exactly the same slides the authors have presented, because it's supposed to be your synthesis, right, of the papers. And please try to focus on have the authors actually solved the problem? Can we do something better, such that we can discuss what we can do in that area going forward. So it'll be more research focused. And I'd like everyone to participate. That's why we'll make the papers available. And thank you for volunteering, the two of you. It'll be some other people the week after that. So to plan this better, this is like the pipeline fill latency, right? We need to fill the pipeline with two presenters for next week. So we're going to fill the pipeline for the rest of the course. And I'll be presenting sometime also. But there'll be a sign-up sheet for later weeks. So the same question will arise for the week after. So we should put that sign-up sheet and you can sign up for the remaining weeks. Is that fine? Okay. So think about selecting some papers. I think what I would like people to do is to sign up for slots right now. Selecting papers we can do later. Okay? So for example, next week you two are presenting. The week after, who's volunteering? Maybe you can select that for now also. Okay, Amir Ali is volunteering for maybe Tuesday, the first day, let's say. Who's next? All right, Young has volunteered for the week. Okay, so we have the next two for, that's great. So we have four presenters for the next 2 weeks. That's good. So we'll have, Yishin, you can update the sign-up sheet for next 2 weeks. Amir Ali is not next Tuesday, but the Tuesday after. And Young is Thursday after that. And we'll pick the papers. If you have suggestions for papers, please send them. I'll have to vet them, of course. But I have some suggestions also. So maybe we'll come to a good set of papers. OK, that's great. And hopefully we'll have a good discussion. Maybe we'll come up with some big ideas also, right? OK. So I think what I would like to do is, this may be kind of like a discussion or lecture, depending on how you guys want to do it. But this is actually a talk that's based on the paper, that book chapter that you read and reviewed. I haven't read your reviews yet, so I have no idea what you wrote, because they were due yesterday. And I think the last review was submitted after midnight yesterday. I get all these email messages whenever someone submits a review. But this is actually a talk that I've been giving at different places based on that book chapter. Or it's more accurate that the talk and book chapter have evolved together over time. But I'd like to kind of go over it if you're interested in this. And this will kind of be a summary of the paper and maybe potential upsides. And we can discuss the upsides and downsides of the mechanisms that are discussed in the paper, as well as the problems that are discussed as we go along. Is that a good thing to do for today? OK. Yeah, let's do it then. So I titled it the Rethinking Memory / Storage System Design. I started out calling this Rethinking Memory System Design, but I think these two are really merging going forward with emerging technologies. And that's a really exciting area, too. OK. I think I've shown you this picture many times, but in the last lecture also. So main memory system. That's what you read about, right, in the book chapter. It's a critical component of all computing systems. I do not know of any system that doesn't have main memory, some kind of working storage. But this must scale in many, many dimensions to maintain performance growth and technology scaling benefits that we've been used to so far. Size, technology, efficiency, cost, management algorithms, and maybe other things also. Reliability, for example, right, which is becoming a bigger issue going forward. This is another view of the memory system, a shared resource view, which I will briefly talk about early on. Basically, if you look at a system, a node today, most of the real estate is really dedicated to the memory system. Right? This is a cartoon that is supposed to emphasize this even more. The reality is not this bad, actually. Only the red parts are computation units. Right? Now, this is not necessarily true in all systems. GPUs actually have a lot of computation units. Right? But even if you look at the GPUs, the register files, which are really part of the memory system, if you think of it, part of data movement and storage, they occupy a huge portion of the space. But basically, going forward, computation is relatively cheap, whereas moving data and storing data is becoming a lot more expensive. And that's why we're actually dedicating most of our real estate in the chip and within the context of the entire system also to data storage and movement. Which has several implications, basically. This is part of the bottleneck of the system. If you look at the buses, these are one of the major bottlenecks, right, in the memory controllers. and maybe the storage also, especially if this becomes fast. And also the second implication is that a lot of these resources are really shared across all of these computation units. So it's really a shared resource across the cores. So this leads to a lot of problems, in my opinion. So this is what you read, basically. There are some recent technology, architecture, and application trends that lead to some new requirements and that exacerbate some old requirements. I'll talk about some of these. If you've taken 740, you've seen some of this, but this is an updated version. The paper you read argues that DRAM and memory controllers, as we know of them today, are unlikely to satisfy all of the requirements. And maybe we should rethink some of these. And there are some emerging memory technologies that enable new opportunities, right? And that seem to be more scalable than DRAM. And these actually happen to be non-volatile. That's the interesting part. They're emerging, but they're also non-volatile. So given these, which we will discuss in a little bit, we need to rethink the entire main memory system to fix some of the issues we're having with DRAM and memory controllers and enable some of these emerging technologies going forward while satisfying all of the requirements. So let's talk about, basically this is kind of the outline of the paper that you read also, except put in a different way. Let's talk about some of these trends affecting main memory. These are, as what I see them, if you think about other trends, let's discuss them also here. Basically, there's an increasing need for main memory capacity, bandwidth, and quality of service, right? We want more capacity, more bandwidth, and better predictability from the memory system. And this is really due to, in my opinion, three major things. One is we're putting increasingly more computational units, whether they are cores, heterogeneous cores, or accelerators. I call them agents. Agents are probably the best way of describing them. They're sharing the memory system. As a result, the capacity need and the bandwidth need is increasing, and they're interfering with each other, so quality of service need is also increasing. Applications are increasingly data intensive, and I think this is not going to change going forward. Most applications that we have today are data intensive, and that is driving the capacity and bandwidth needs. And we're consolidating more and more in all systems, like cloud computing. We would like to be more efficient in terms of area and energy. Even with heterogeneous systems like CPUs, GPUs, the cell phone that I have somewhere, it consolidates a lot of things, right? You want to run many, many things at the same time to improve efficiency and to improve response times. As a result, you have many things running at the same time. Capacity, bandwidth, and quality of service needs are increasing. This is kind of an old chart from ISCA 2009. It's a paper by HP Labs in Michigan. Actually, we could put that in our reading list also. It's a good paper that basically shows that core count is doubling approximately every 2 years, which is this one, this curve over here, and DRAM DIMM capacity is doubling approximately every 3 years. Right? As a result, memory capacity per core is expected to drop by 30% every 2 years, which is pretty bad because software has relied on more memory capacity to actually put more features, right? And also improve performance as well. That would be something really interesting to plot. What are the memory capacity requirements of Windows over time, let's say? That could be really interesting to superimpose to this, right? I bet it's really increasing heavily. That's true for actually all of the operating systems that I know of. But I don't know the exact curve. I don't know how the curve looks like. So if one of you is interested in doing that, you can. That could be an interesting exercise. So it's a problem, basically. Software has relied on this, and we're not having more capacity per core. As a result, how can you sustain the software development, right? And if you think about it, in the end, it's really the applications that are exposed, that are really driving the innovation. As computer architects, when we provide memory capacity, we're really driving the innovation at the application level. If you're not enabling the software programmer to drive that innovation, create new applications, improve the performance of new applications, if you're making life really hard for the software programmer to achieve that innovation, then you're really hindering innovation. That's why I think this trend is bad. You don't want memory capacity per core to drop, because you're really forcing the application writers to actually parallelize their applications, which is a tough task, which some of our papers will be concerned about, hopefully, also. Okay, actually, this may be another exercise for you. If you plot memory bandwidth per core, and some of you may be interested in doing that, just to see the trends. The trends are much worse. Basically, memory bandwidth per core, I believe, is increasing by approximately 10% every year. And now there may be a step one can shift over there when you go to actually something like high bandwidth memory, right? Or 3D stacked or 2.5D stacked memory. But there are trade-offs associated with it, right? If you actually do 3D stacking of memory on top of the processor, you can have a lot more bandwidth because you're connecting memory with the through silicon vias to the processor, right? Or some interposer, silicon interposer with 2.5D, people call it 2.5D. You're increasing memory bandwidth significantly because you have a lot more connections between the processor and memory. As a result, you're maybe going off the curve. Instead of increasing 10% every year, you're maybe going, I don't know, 50%. I don't actually remember what it is. But the problem is that's not the solution because you can add that memory that you're stacking on top of the processor is limited in terms of capacity, right? It's not going to be as high capacity as the DIMMs because, first of all, you have limited form factor, and you cannot stack indefinitely because stacking, in the end, is limited by thermal constraints, right? Because traditionally, processors have been cooled from the top, right? And if you actually, yeah, go ahead. And yield, that's right, yeah. There are other issues in stacking, right? Yield, reliability, how to do testing. People are trying to figure that out. As a result, well, yield eventually affects cost, right? So the stacked memory will probably be a lot more costly. And that's actually true right now. That's another reason why its capacity will be limited as well. So in a sense, stacked memory will change the trend for memory bandwidth per core a little bit, but it has its own different trade-offs, which will bring us to hybrid memory systems that we've discussed today. So perhaps you have some stacked memory that is really close to the processor that is fast, low latency, high bandwidth, low capacity, and you have some other memory, DRAM, that's far away from the processor, that's slower, low capacity, well, high capacity, low bandwidth. And then the key question is, how do you allocate data across those two different memories, across multiple applications, right? But anyway, it's good to plot this, I think. It's good to talk about some of these other technologies also. The paper you're reading doesn't talk, one of the downsides of that paper, I'll give you some of the downsides, it doesn't talk about 3D stacking as much, right? And maybe you've written this in your comments, so. But that's one of my criticisms of my paper. Maybe, if I had time, I will add that at some point. But I think looking at this kind of memory and its use would be really interesting as part of a project also. And one of the other things that stacked memory enables, especially if you stack logic and memory together, and maybe you have some processing capability in that logic, one of the key questions is, how do you exploit that processing capability really well? And I think one of the key things is, what are the applications, like what are the primitives that you should add to that logic layer in stacked memory such that you can accelerate a large fraction of important applications? So that could be a really good project topic also. So if you're interested in exploring in-memory computation or close to memory in DRAM computation, for example, you can take a look at some of those mechanisms that you can put into stacked memory. You can take an important application, let's say, and try to figure out what you can do close to memory and what you can do close to processor to accelerate that application. That could be a really interesting project topic. And today is the right time to do this, actually. People have looked at processing in memory for a long time. And these could be some papers to read. Yishin, are you hearing me?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Maybe you can take some of the notes on the papers that I discussed. So maybe we can put those on the reading list. There's actually a really old paper by David Elliott Shaw, I believe from the 1970s, that it's called the Nan-Wan database machine, Nan-Wan Neumann database machine. That's one of the earliest papers on processing in memory, in my opinion. Basically, he suggests that a lot of processing should happen in a database machine in memory and talks about how to do that. So this is from the 1970s. So the idea is really old, actually. There are later papers, of course, like the ExecCube from Peter Kogi from 1996, International Conference on Parallel Processing, that basically suggests putting a processor right by memory and doing a general purpose processor right by memory and doing computation in there. What are the downsides of putting a general purpose processor in memory? Say it again.
You already have a general purpose.
Well, far away, yes, that's right. But if you put it in DRAM, then you have a problem, right? Because DRAM process is really optimized for the capacitor, minimizing the capacitor. So it's a very different process than logic. So people have looked at it in a general purpose way, processing in memory. For example, IRAM, intelligent RAM. Again, there's a really good paper on the case for intelligent RAM in IEEE Micro in 1997. And there are other, actually, I believe it's 1996. But there's an ISCA paper also that looks at the energy efficiency of the IRAM architectures. I believe that's in 1997. And they look at the promise, or premise, or both, of putting a general purpose processor on top of the DRAM logic and doing vector operations on that, which could be a really good idea, except technology. There's a huge technology barrier there, right? At least with the DRAM technology. It's very difficult to put a very fast general purpose processor in DRAM. It increases your cost, reduces your yield significantly, because the DRAM process is not optimized for that. But that said, maybe some other technologies may be good for this, right? STT-MRAM could be very interesting, for example, for something like this. Maybe some of you can present the STT-MRAM papers. I don't know. Anyway, I think I'm going to a lot of discussion right now. Hopefully this will give you some project ideas too. I was saying processing in memory is interesting today, I think, because the trends are much worse. Like energy, like we're really limited by the bottleneck of the memory system. If you look at a GPU today, it's really limited by the memory system. And a lot of the applications are limited by the memory system. And energy is really limited by that bus between the processor and memory. So maybe it's the right time to examine. And overwhelmingly, the systems we design are really moving computation, data to computation, right? Everything you see is moving data to computation. There's nothing that moves computation to data today, as far as I know. Well, at the high level, maybe there is. But at the low level, at the node level, that doesn't happen today. I think my phone is telling me to move on. But it's good to examine this, I think, especially in some ways where you can add very low cost to the memory system. Having very high cost solutions will likely not work. But adding very simple things into the memory system such that you can accelerate a good chunk of the operations is a very good way of looking at this. Row clone is one example that we did discuss briefly, right, last time. And that's actually discussed in the paper that you reviewed also. And I will probably get to that too. But what are the other primitives that we can add to the memory system such that we can, in DRAM, let's say, such that we can accelerate these applications? I definitely encourage you to look into that. Especially with these trends, I think it's really necessary to do that right now. OK, next trend. Energy and power is a key system design concern, and the paper talks about this. This is actually a good paper that I would recommend you to read also. It's an old paper by Charles Lafergy from IBM Research in Austin. And they've analyzed IBM's big iron systems, and they figured out that approximately 40 to 50% of this entire system energy is spent on the off-chip memory hierarchy. This includes off-chip caches, off-chip interconnect, off-chip memory, off-chip storage, dot, dot, dot. They didn't have a breakdown, if I remember correctly, but they may have had it in a different paper. So this is becoming a bigger problem. And DRAM consumes power even when it's not used, because you need to periodically refresh it. And this is one of the problems that I will discuss later on also. This is actually this is another really interesting topic. Basically, how do you design really energy efficient DRAM? Or energy efficient memory system in general? Because DRAM is overwhelmingly designed for cost today, right? It's not designed for in-memory computation. That's one way of looking at it. How do you actually design in-memory computation in DRAM? But how do you actually also minimize energy in DRAM today? That's actually a good problem to solve also. And I'll actually recommend another paper over here soon that says that one of the major problems in DRAM is actually periodic refresh to scale DRAM. And on top of this, DRAM technology scaling is ending. And this may be a strong word, but actually industry is feeling the heat for this. So ITRS, International Technology of Roadmap of Semiconductors, publishes a report, I believe every year, or maybe every couple of years, that talks about the technology trends. And they've been saying that DRAM will not scale easily below X nanometers over the years. And they've been changing X over the years. That's why I keep X over here, so that I don't need to change my slide every time they change X. But scaling, what does scaling mean? You reduce the size of the DRAM circuit, right? And you would like to do that to increase the capacity, density, hopefully lower the cost, and hopefully have good energy scaling, right? If these are not continuing, then we have a problem, right? Then we cannot build larger memory systems that have higher capacity, higher bandwidth, that are reasonable cost and reasonable energy. And this is happening because the circuit is becoming much less reliable when you reduce the size of the circuit, right? And I'll give you some examples. One example of this, the paper that you read discusses some of the scaling issues. And I believe this is another topic to do research on. And we actually have infrastructure that you can use. Actually, we have infrastructure. If you're interested in any of these topics, there is infrastructure that we can provide that exists both in my group and also publicly available infrastructure. You should definitely talk with me and Yixin on any of the topics, actually, not only these, because there is infrastructure on other things also. But let's talk about the DRAM scaling problem a little bit more. If you look at DRAM, it consists of, by the way, before that, any other trends that you think of in memory? I think this, I didn't put reliability here because this is really related to reliability. Because scaling, ending meaning is basically you cannot produce not only large DRAM, but also reliable DRAM. And actually, that's one of the issues that I will talk about. But any other trends that you can think of? No? It covers everything? Okay. Okay, so let's look at this a little bit. The problem is DRAM stores charge in this capacitor, and it has this access transistor. And both of these need to be large enough for reliability and low energy. Right? This access transistor should be large enough such that the capacitor doesn't leak, right? Or leaks less, and retains its charge. And this capacitor should be large enough such that you can reliably sense this thing. And sensing happens by discharging the capacitor, right? Once you discharge the capacitor, you can sense it perturbs this bit line, charge sharing happens, and you can sense the perturbation with the sense amplifier that is over here. And if the charge is really little over here, maybe you're not able to sense it, right? Actually, the sense amplifier is really large. You read a paragraph about that in the TLDRAM portion of the memory scaling paper, right? We'll get to that, but this. As you reduce the size of this, this becomes unreliable. As a result, and this was the value that was assigned to X, by the way, by ITRS in 2009. In their 2009 report, they say scaling DRAM beyond the feature size of 40 to 35 nanometers is challenging. And that is true. It is challenging, actually. Today, DRAM manufacturers are manufacturing DRAM at 20 nanometer node. So they've come to 20 nanometers, but it has come at a cost. So. And reliability concerns is one of the things. And I'll give you one example that my students have actually discovered, which is the Rowhammer problem. How many of you are familiar with it? No, Rowhammer? Maybe some of you. Yes, you read the paper, so. But many of you may not have. So this is actually a very recent paper that was published in ISCA 2014. And I would recommend this paper. Maybe someone can present something like this, for example, as part of the reading. Because we'll do a lot of reading over the course. So if you're really excited about one paper, if you think there can be more research in this area, you can present it. You don't have to. By the way, the presentations, the papers you present, you don't have those do not have to be the review papers. You can tell me you would like to present this paper, and if I approve, then you can present that paper. So this could be a paper, for example. So we're actually seeing the problem with scaling. Actually, there have been errors that have manifested themselves in the field that did not manifest themselves before. And one example is this Rowhammer problem. What is the problem? Basically, this is a DRAM bank. You can think of this as a DRAM bank. Basically, each bank has a bunch of rows, 512 to 1024. That's the subarray, actually. The entire bank has maybe 32 subarrays, so you have 32,000 of these rows. But if you do this to a DRAM bank, basically, this is an activate. Activate means you apply a high voltage to the word line, right? You activate the word line. And then you can deactivate this, right? Activate precharge, activate precharge. You could keep doing this. And if you keep doing this for many, many, many times within a refresh interval for a row, today errors start appearing in rows that are adjacent to this row in today's DRAM. Actually, in many of today's DRAM chips. If you've gotten DRAM between 2010 and 2014, it's very likely that you will get this kind of errors. You can actually demonstrate this. So all of the chips that Junge has tested that were manufactured between 2010 and 2014 actually exhibit this type of errors, all of them that we've tested. So you can call this the aggressor row, and these are kind of the victim rows, right? And the problem is bad because this row may contain data from a process that's totally different, right? And you're just reading this row. You're just activating, reading it. You're not even writing to it. You don't need to write to it, right? So you can actually corrupt memory of some other process. And it could be, you could do this in a virtual machine too. So the problem, well, why does the problem happen? You can read the paper if you're really interested, and I would definitely recommend that. The problem happens because you reduce the size of these structures, and you have a lot of coupling between the bit lines and the word lines and between different cells, right? Whatever you do to this cell now affects the cells around it. And I'll take a step back, actually. This is a very well-known problem in memory in general, right? It's disturbance. It's intercell interference. It's called I don't know, why am I? Sorry about that. I wasn't supposed to set an alarm at this time, but I forgot it, apparently. But it's called intercell interference. Whenever you scale memory to really small sizes, this kind of effect happens. It's really nothing new. Even with the first DRAMs, Intel 1103 had this kind of errors or similar errors. The issue is those errors were hidden from people who actually bought DRAM, right? Today, all DRAMs that we've tested have this kind of error. And they're exposed to the user. They're exposed to people who are using these laptops, right? And also, other types of memory has this kind of errors also. Flash memory, for example. And I definitely recommend some of you to do research in flash memory or present some papers in flash memory. Flash memory has this kind of errors also. It's called read disturb, or it's called program interference. There are two different types. Actually, flash memory has different kinds of errors. So whenever you program a row, it's a little bit different from this. You're actually changing the voltage levels. Well, in flash memory, it's called a page. Whenever you program a page, you're actually changing the voltage levels in the neighboring cells in neighboring pages in flash memory. It's called program interference. So it's very similar. There's also read disturb. Whenever you read, you're disturbing the other cells around it. And all of these are really issues with what happens to memory when you scale to very small sizes. You get these intercell interference effects. Hard disks have this also, by the way. It's called adjacent track interference. Whenever you read a track, the adjacent track gets disturbed. The good thing about those systems, flash and hard disk, is they're not supposed to be perfect memory, right? In a sense, in DRAM, we treat DRAM as kind of perfect memory. It's not supposed to have any errors. But flash memory, it's OK to have errors. Why? Because there's a flash translation layer. There's this controller that is supposed to correct those errors, right? And it has very heavyweight error correction codes that it employs that corrects these errors. It masks those errors. It's very actually complicated, flash memory. It's pretty interesting. If you actually manufacture flash, most of the cells don't work. You need this controller to actually do correction, right? That's true for hard disk even more, actually, because the technology has scaled down to much, much smaller sizes right over there. And the technology is very different also. But yeah, you have this, in a sense, those are a system by itself. You have the hard disk controller that does a lot of error correction also, right? But in DRAM, we don't have that, right? In DRAM, this doesn't have any error correction in it, right? It's just. So that's good. We'll talk about that, actually. We have ECC for server chips. That increases, obviously, cost. But not in the consumer devices, right? Actually, I don't know of any consumer device that is mass sold that has error correction. But let's wait for a few slides. We'll see that, actually, some manufacturers are proposing in DRAM ECC today, which is a very big change, which demonstrates the importance of the problem, actually, right? Previously, people thought of ECC in DRAM, within the DRAM chip, as something not good because it increased cost significantly, right? DRAM has been designed for cost. But if you start getting this kind of effects, maybe it's time to reconsider DRAM a little bit. That's why I think this is a really important area to look at today. How do you actually design the DRAM system, memory system, such that you can overcome some of these challenges? Okay. Anyway, basically, repeatedly opening and closing a row induces these disturbance errors. And you need to do it enough times within a refresh interval. So if you refresh the victim rows, then the effect is gone, right? You can read the paper. I would definitely recommend reading this paper. We should put that on the reading list, Ishan, if it's not already there. So, okay, just a preview of the paper for you. Basically, these were the chips that Yunggu and my other students have tested from three different companies that are supposed to remain anonymous, but you can guess who they are. There aren't many DRAM companies in the world because the market has been very much cost-driven, right? And the big companies have basically driven out the other smaller companies from the field. But these are the fraction of the memory modules that actually exhibit these errors out of all the ones that are tested. Here, for example, for company A, 37 out of 43 exhibited these errors. And it turns out none of the modules before that were manufactured before 2010 exhibited these errors, but everything that was manufactured after 2010 exhibited these errors. So if you look at the paper, there's a graph over there. That's right, yes. So the issue is related to some process technology. Basically, you're scaling down. And maybe going forward, these errors will go away. But I think the overall thing is it's become difficult for these manufacturers to actually contain this kind of effects when the technology scales down to smaller sizes. So I definitely recommend that you read this paper. So how do you actually induce these errors? This is a kernel that Yunggu wrote as part of a mem test. So you can actually run this and, of course, ensure that X and Y actually map to the same bank. And actually, this code is available online on my group's website. You can take it. You can experiment with it if you want. Other people have done that from industry. And what this code does is basically it repeatedly accesses X and Y in an interleaved way. You access X, you access Y, X, Y, X, Y, X, Y, and errors start appearing over here. And then you can count the errors, right, by reading the adjacent things, by reading the entire DRAM and checking. So it's good to think about how to do these experiments also. And if you're interested in this kind of studies, if you want to test, for example, some DRAM that's already bad, maybe you know already bad. Actually, we have some DRAM that's already bad. You can actually test for errors with our infrastructure. But you can do this on your system also. You can download this code and run it and see if you get errors. I'm curious if how many of you will get the errors. Other people at Microsoft actually have gotten these errors because they were really interested in this when they read the paper and they wanted the code and they actually tested this. And they found that there were actually errors in their virtual machines when they tested it in their systems. So they're looking at fixes to the problem. Okay. So it's actually relatively easy to do that. And this is actually scary because in any common system that you may get today, you can get these errors if you use a DIMM that was manufactured between 2010 and 2014. So this is a serious reliability issue. Although that you can ask, like, if you actually want to criticize this paper, I'll give you some examples of weaknesses. Basically, this paper doesn't demonstrate that this happens in real applications. Right? This is kind of a kernel. It's good that it demonstrates that. Basically, it uncovers a new reliability issue, but it doesn't show that it happens in real applications. The key question remains, how often does this happen in a real application? Right? This kernel can cause a lot of errors, good, but what are the applications? Or what are the application-level communication mechanisms that lead to this? So you may be interested in thinking about this. So it's a reliability issue, but it's also a security issue, right? If you think about it, if you can somehow take advantage of these errors, maybe you can actually take over the system. There are actually some really good papers. If some of you are interested in security, you may want to present some security papers also. But this is not a security paper. Actually, let me, Yishin, why don't you remind me of finding a security paper? I don't want to do it right now. Maybe we can add security to the reading list. Okay, there's actually a really interesting paper from Princeton that was published in around 2002. They basically attacked a virtual machine by inducing errors in memory. And what they did was, they actually did not have this kind of mechanism, but what they did was they actually heated memory physically, and that caused some bit flips. And they had a mechanism that checked those for those bit flips. And if a bit flip actually occurred at a critical part of the virtual machine, you can take advantage of it by jumping to the routine that they have written. And they can take over the virtual machine that way. We should perhaps read that paper as part of the reading list, because it's pretty cool. So the mechanism they used to induce those errors, which made the attacks, in my opinion, less realistic, was to actually heat the DRAM. And you have to have physical access to be able to do that, right? Well, maybe you can get those errors this way. Right? You don't need to heat the DRAM now. It turns out these errors are actually pretty predictable. Like they occur in locations. So the way they took advantage of it, because they didn't know which locations the error occurred, right? Basically, it was by pure luck. If it occurred at a critical part that actually stored a pointer, for example, to an important part, that's how I don't remember the details, so that's why we should read the paper. But now I'm going to find out and tell you the paper such that Yixin can put it up. So that's how I search for papers. Oh, there you go. Using memory errors to attack a virtual machine. It's IEEE Symposium on Security and Privacy 2003. So before Yixin, let me send it to Yixin also. Yixin, are you hearing us?
Yeah.
How do I write to you? Oh, there you go.
Maybe you can show your screen.
I can share my screen?
Yeah.
Okay, how do I do that? Say it again. Go back to the plus. Thank you. Share screen. Okay, there you go. Share your entire screen. Start. Okay, let's hope that that doesn't do bad things to our connection. Okay, are you seeing my screen? Yeah. Okay, good. All right, so I would definitely recommend that paper. One of you maybe can present it during this term. So security is actually an important issue also in systems today. And providing architectural support to fix some of the security issues is definitely an important problem in architecture and systems in general. OK? I guess we're covering a lot of papers now. So you can. There are lots of presentations to do. And that could actually trigger a lot of discussion on what can we do in security? So that would be a really good paper to trigger the discussion, maybe in combination with the flipping bits in the DRAM paper. That's very recent. And maybe one of you can design an attack that can take advantage of this, right? So OK, attack is good, but how do you actually solve the problem is another issue, right? So these are obviously errors have been demonstrated, but how do you actually solve the problem? You don't want to talk about just the problem, but you would like to solve the problem also. So the paper actually contains a list of solutions. Unfortunately, none of them is really perfect in the sense that none of them you can implement immediately, very easily, at low cost. Why? Because, well, this is a problem, right? You're getting these errors. You need to somehow fix the problem. One of the fixes, for example, increasing the refresh rate. Right? You could double the refresh rate and reduce the probability of these errors significantly. But that's not a great solution, right? Refresh is already bad. If you double your refresh rate, you're reducing your memory throughput. You're increasing your energy.
Can you do selective refreshing like greater? Like if you know you're actually like having these rows, move them somewhere, let you know that it's critical,
yeah.
And have only that thing having the selective refresh rate higher.
I see. So that's a good point, basically. Selectively refresh the rows that can potentially be affected, right? And potentially be affected may mean maybe some rows are more vulnerable to this, if you can identify those. Then the key question is, how do you identify those? It turns out that's a difficult problem, by the way. There's another paper that we've written. Maybe it's not related to these rows, but I would definitely recommend that other paper. That's in ISCA 2013. It's an experimental study of DRAM retention failures. I will probably cover that briefly. Identifying those rows may be difficult. But I think there's another way of selectively refreshing. You can say maybe you can figure out which rows are being attacked, almost, because you keep accessing the same row. If you can find out, if you access some row repeatedly, maybe you can refresh the neighbors, right? Such that the neighbors do not have this effect. Then the key question is, how do you identify the neighbors? There are two key questions over there, right? How do you identify the row that's attacking others? And how do you identify the neighbors? It turns out today's DRAM chips don't tell you about their internal organization. Right? It's all, yeah, it's so. There you go. Yeah, basically, You send it a physical address, but
you can't find the neighbors.
You can't find the neighbors.
Based on your physical address.
Yeah. So there's some scrambling that happens in the address space, and there's remapping that happens. So you need support from the DRAM chip, which doesn't exist today, which could be provided, I think, going forward. There's no reason not to provide it to the memory controller, right? But that's definitely a good idea, I think. Yes.
So why don't we remap the data to other rows? For example, as soon as we got too many access to a row, remap that data to other rows.
I see.
That
particular physical row. Yeah, you could do that. I mean, that happens in Flash sometimes, right? Not necessarily for this problem, but you do a lot of remapping in Flash when you do programming. You could do that. I guess then you somehow need to identify the row that you're accessing, which may not be that bad, right? Yeah. That's right. That could be a potential solution that could be implementable at relatively low cost today without requiring support. Well, maybe you should talk with Yungu. Yes, you had.
Yeah. So I think, how about we put hot rows together and put not so hot cold rows together?
I see. Basically, what you're saying is if you put hot rows together,
yeah.
Well, by remapping somehow, then you won't have this problem because all of them will be accessing.
Yeah.
Then the problem is your memory bandwidth will be limited, right? You'll put all of those rows that you're accessing very frequently in the same bank. Then yeah, you decrease your throughput significantly because you have all these banks that are idle while you're accessing this bank heavily. Yeah.
Or we evenly distribute the hot rows in each bank.
Yeah, I guess, but then you need to be somehow lucky, right?
Yeah.
That's right. Maybe even distribution usually works in providing potential statistical guarantees, but somebody can always design an attack that can overcome that. Yeah. I see. That's actually interesting. Yeah, you have basically, I like that idea actually. Basically, you're proposing heterogeneous DRAM. Some part is for critical data that is security critical. Some part is for non-critical data. And the security critical DRAM is more reliable, let's say. That's a nice idea. I like the idea of heterogeneity for sure. So Yishin has looked at heterogeneous reliability memory. So that could be an application of that. But there may be other reasons why you build that memory, right?
Yeah,
that's not a direct solution. Exactly. It doesn't get rid of the problem, right? It kind of reduces the effect of the problem on security. Because you'll be vulnerable to this in the unreliable portion. Well, maybe it doesn't matter as much. Because maybe there's some data where you're not as much affected by errors, right? Actually, I recommend Yishin's paper too. It is a paper in DSN that basically talks about heterogeneous reliability memory. He characterizes some of these applications that are used in data centers, so search being one of them. And you can actually characterize data as vulnerable data, data vulnerable to errors and data less vulnerable to errors. And if you can somehow do this distinction, you can put the vulnerable data to reliable memory and less vulnerable data to less reliable memory. And hopefully tolerate the effects at the system level. Because the application may be tolerant, right? There's been a lot of research actually on the tolerance of applications to errors starting from the early 2000s. Actually, maybe even earlier because people have looked at, for example, reducing the precision of floating point operations for a long time in high performance computing such that you can save energy and you can do more computation. And you can be tolerant to some less precise, having less precision in floating point, right? But similarly to this, maybe you can be tolerant to errors, right? Actually, there's another really interesting paper. Maybe I'll give you a lot of these papers. There's another really interesting paper. What they did was, this was in PAC 2004 by Nick Wang, Mike Furt again, Sanjay Patel. Basically what they did was they took spec applications, spec CPU workloads. These are workloads that are less likely to be tolerant to anything, right? GCC, for example. What they did was they actually flipped one branch in an application during an execution, flipped the direction. And I think they found 50% of the time the application ran correctly in the end, even though you flipped the direction of the branch to the wrong direction. It's supposed to be taken, you make it not taken, and the application runs correctly 50% of the time. They actually talk about the different reasons for this. Maybe you don't check the data eventually. Maybe it doesn't matter at the high level. A GCC, for example, has these a lot of steps where you compile the program, you iterate over something, and maybe there are some phases where you don't find optimizations, right? Maybe it doesn't matter, right? At the algorithmic level, you have a lot of fault tolerance as well. So if you can identify these effects, so I'll definitely recommend that paper. Maybe I'll find that as well. Let's see. It's a good way of searching papers, by the way. And then you search for, there you go. Y, they called it the Y branch, is when you've come to a fork in the road, take it. It's a fun paper to read. We have some application analysis also. Okay. So these could be actually really interesting papers to talk about, some of them. There's actually more recent work in this area if you want to present something. Like right now, approximate computing, so-called, is kind of hot. Basically, somehow, can you relax the correctness requirements of the applications at the bit level, let's say, and still get the correct result mostly, right, without degrading the quality of service that the user perceives. And many applications have this kind of tolerance, right? For example, I don't care if one pixel is bad in the screen maybe once in a while, right? If one pixel is consistently bad and I look at that screen, that may be bad. But once in a while, you get something wrong. Maybe it doesn't matter, right? Maybe not with the names of these papers, because I tend to find the errors really easily over here. But if you're playing a game and it's a really fast-moving game and it doesn't matter, maybe one pixel doesn't matter, right? So that's one very tolerant application, for example. Yeah, so thinking about these is interesting. Doing a project on approximate computing would be pretty interesting also. So if you're interested in this, I can recommend you more papers. I had another paper in mind, actually. But anyway, Yixin, perhaps you can put your own paper also. OK.
Yeah.
This is good. We're having a lot of discussion, which means that we're not going to cover the 150 slides I have. But that was the purpose of this class anyway. If you were taking 740, I would be covering the 150 slides. So actually, this is another paper that I would really recommend. This was presented at the Memory Forum. Actually, maybe we can go to that website too. Memory Forum, that's not what I intended. But that's a forum we organized at ISCA this year. And you can take a look at this. If you look at the program, there'll be invited talks from people. You can actually go and click the slides. For example, Bob Brennan from Samsung. I don't know how to. OK, there you go. Presented new directions in memory architecture, right? So this would be a good, you can skip the legal disclaimer, probably. You can actually look at some of the high-level views of a senior Samsung vice president on some of the issues they see in DRAM, flash, and persistent memory, persistent performance, right? So it's actually good to see what people think. But this is not the paper that I was going to talk about. There are some other presentations. But this is the paper that I would definitely recommend. It's a four-page paper. It talks about some of the DRAM scaling challenges that industry is really seeing at the low level, and proposes some solutions to those challenges. So if you're this would complement the memory scaling paper that you read really well. But what do they identify as the challenges? This is a brief summary that I have of the paper using some of their slides. Basically, they identify three major challenges in process scaling at the low level. And refresh is one of them, basically. Like refresh, it's actually, this could be the fundamental limit of DRAM, maybe. It's, in the end, you need to refresh this unfortunate capacitor. And as you reduce the size of it, you need to refresh it more. And as you increase the capacity of it, you need to, more capacitors to refresh, right? It's very difficult to get out of this. And leakage is increasing through the access transistors as they identify, right? So they identify as a key challenge. The second key challenge is TWR, which is write latency. What they find is basically, because of the contact resistance increase between the capacitor and the access transistor, write latency into the DRAM, write recovery latency is increasing. And they actually propose some solutions related to this. And VRT is the third challenge. Do you guys know about VRT? It's called variable retention time. And I'll recommend another paper. Maybe some of you can read about it. VRT is the effect of this, basically. If you look at time, if this is the leakage current of the cell, or retention time of the cell, you can think of it that way. Over time, the cell has low retention time. Sometimes it has high retention time. Sometimes it has low retention time, high retention time. It moves between these two states. It's called variable retention time. And this is actually a well-known problem in DRAM. It's because of some random effect that causes charge to get trapped in the access transistor once in a while. So sometimes you get this charge trap that happens in the access transistor. As a result, capacitor leaks much faster. This is called trap-assisted gate-induced drain leakage, TAGIDL. It's a mouthful. But that's the reason why this happens, and it's a random effect. As you reduce the size of the circuit, apparently this effect increases. So, and this obviously affects refresh, right? Because if you have a cell that exhibits this effect, VRT, think about it. The cell can have, today you refresh every cell every 64 milliseconds, right? A cell can have, let's say, a retention time of 32 milliseconds sometimes, or 64 milliseconds, let's say. But sometimes its retention time is 100 seconds. If you want to figure out the cell with the minimum retention time, you need to basically do enough testing to actually ensure that you hit the low retention time period, right? And it turns out you can actually stay in this high retention time period for a long time. And I'll actually recommend another paper that my students had written. I'll send this to Yishin. You can find it over here. Actually, maybe some of you can present it. OK. An experimental study of data retention behavior. So this analyzes these effects, including VRT, in modern DRAM devices using the infrastructure that's sitting outside over here, which I would definitely encourage some of you to use. But basically, I'll give you an example of the VRT cell here. OK, maybe I won't be able to because my screen is not cooperating with me. OK, there you go. So this is what you see in real experiments, for example, the retention time of a typical VRT cell. And this is done at low temperature, like 45 degrees Celsius. That's why you see the retention time as 2 seconds. And it's varying between 2 seconds to 6 seconds. Right. So I definitely recommend this paper. And Samsung and Intel together, which are kind of unlikely partners, right? Identify this as one of the major challenges in DRAM scaling also. So then the key question is actually, how do you fix this problem? So this is bad, actually, because in that paper, if you read it, you will see that this VRT or retention time is who figures out the minimum retention time is important, right? You need to set the refresh rate, you need to figure out the minimum retention time of a cell. It turns out minimum retention time of a cell changes if you expose a cell to high temperature. So you manufacture DRAM, you have the chip. Now you're soldering it on some board. When you're doing soldering, or DIMM, when you're doing that, you're exposing the chip to high temperatures, actually. The retention time profile changes, which means that to be able to do refresh going into the future, maybe someone else should determine the retention time, not necessarily the DRAM manufacturer, right? Maybe you should have the system determining the retention time. Then the key question is, how do you do it, right? You plug DRAM into the system, and you start testing it. And over time, you figure out the retention time of all cells, and you have a map of retention time. And maybe you apply optimizations like Radar over time. You figure out different retention time for different parts, and you refresh things at different rates, right? As a result, you can have a much more efficient system. But then the key question is, how do you actually figure out the retention time given you have VRT? Right? So I would definitely recommend thinking about this direction also. How do you actually design an online profiling system? And for that, I would recommend another paper. I'll send this to Yixin also. I guess Yixin is still here, right?
Yes.
Okay, good. So I'd recommend Samira's paper also, which talks about an example of that online profiling system, but it doesn't fully develop it. Okay. I guess I've spent a lot of time on the slide. But we should definitely have someone review this paper or read this paper maybe. Maybe I'll put it on the review list if no one picks up the paper. But this is the earliest four-page paper that describes. So basically, they actually propose some solutions to the problem also. And one of the there are several solutions they propose. For example, for getting rid of the VRT issues or reducing the VRT issues, they talk about in-DRAM ECC, right? Basically using, and maybe even here. Did I take the paper? Yeah, there you go. Yeah, they talk about, for example, sub-array level parallelism, which is one of the solutions Jung and Vivek had proposed in ISCA 2012. That's another paper I would recommend if you're going to focus on DRAM. That they talk about this as a potential solution to the write latency problem. Because you can actually hide the write latency if you access subarrays almost independently. And the paper actually shows that. That's one of the potential solutions they actually advocate. But the other solution that they advocate, which is interesting, I think, is in-DRAM ECC to solve some of the issues that happen with single bit failures as well as VRT. And this is really interesting, I think, because, as I said before, ECC is very commonly used in other memories like flash and disk, but in DRAM, people have avoided it. Today, what people do in ECC, in DRAM, if you want to have reliable DRAM, is you have another chip, right, that's dedicated for ECC. So if you look at an ECC DIMM, you have, let's say, 9 of these chips instead of 8 of these chips. And one of the chips is really dedicated to store ECC information. So it's really outside of the DRAM chip. You're increasing cost by buying one more chip to store error correcting codes. But here they're proposing, oh, why don't we put ECC inside the DRAM arrays, inside the chip? So that increases, obviously, the cost. So we'll see, I guess, if this happens going into the future. OK, so and the other interesting thing about this paper is it's written by some senior architects from both Samsung and Intel. And it's interesting that they collaborate to write the paper, at least. OK, any questions? Any thoughts? Okay. Let's talk about some potential solution directions. And these will lead to maybe some project ideas, some paper discussions later on. Basically, there are two potential solutions, the first one, I think, is very similar to the solution they advocate that we've been advocating for a while. In the paper that you read in the book chapter, I talk about this also, right? Tolerating DRAM. Basically, we should perhaps take a fresh look at it, though. And a fresh look may be co-architecting controllers and DRAM together, as people have been doing for a long time in flash memory, in hard disks also. Maybe we should have a DRAM translation layer, like flash memory, flash translation layer, right? Then the key issue is, how do you design that DRAM translation layer to be very efficient? Because DRAM is on the order of tens of nanoseconds. Flash is 10x, or even even slower, right? Actually, 100x, right? Is that true? 100x is probably the two orders of magnitude. So you can do maybe a lot of slow things in the flash translation layer, but you cannot afford that in the DRAM translation layer. But basically, we should perhaps take a fresh look at it. And maybe the other solution direction is, maybe we should be looking at some other technology. That's always true when something is not scaling, right? And we should perhaps be doing both. That's what the paper that you read, memory scaling paper, main memory scaling, argues, right? So let's take a look at the first solution direction. We're not going to cover all of these. But what do I mean by tolerating DRAM? Maybe we should be overcoming DRAM shortcomings by taking a fresh look at the DRAM architecture. And I call this the system DRAM co-design. Instead of design DRAM alone, design the system and DRAM together. And this leads to some novel DRAM architectures, new interfaces, new functions in DRAM. And perhaps we should be doing better waste management. So there's several key issues to tackle. Actually, a lot of these we talked about already. Reducing energy, I think, is critical. And enabling reliability at low cost is critical. And these are two sides of the same coin, in my opinion. So refresh is a reliability problem, right? You're really having this unreliable DRAM. It's leaking. And you're solving the problem by expending a lot of energy, right? Refreshing. And there's an interesting trade-off between energy and reliability in many systems, in my opinion. For example, in caches also, you can reduce energy significantly in caches by operating at low voltages. People, actually, anything, any logic, people are looking at near threshold voltage computing, where you reduce the voltage, the supply voltage, to be very similar to the threshold voltage, such that you're operating at very, very low leakage. The problem is, once you do that, the circuit becomes much less reliable. It becomes more prone to any kind of perturbances. So there's that trade-off. You can reduce energy significantly, but that increases your reliability. That decreases your reliability, likely. Or you can increase your reliability by expending more energy. Right? So it's good to think about this trade-off. And examining this trade-off within the context of DRAM would be really interesting. So if some of you is really interested in doing something like this, might be very encouraging with that, including using the infrastructure that the other papers that I recommended talks about. The other issue is improving bandwidth and latency. I mean, these are traditional things, right? Improving DRAM bandwidth has been very traditional, but it's becoming even more important. And doing it at very low cost is really important. Reducing latency is really important going forward. How do you do that? This hasn't been the focus of manufacturers for a long time, but people should be looking at reducing latency. So this is part of the new DRAM architectures. And I guess since some of you have taken 447 and 740, but bandwidth and latency are kind of two duals also, right? You can tolerate latency by adding more bandwidth if you can actually exploit concurrency, right? Automated execution processors do that, right? They tolerate the latency of long latency operations by doing multiple things at the same time. But to do multiple things at the same time, you need more bandwidth, whether it be execution bandwidth, memory bandwidth. You need that kind of bandwidth, right? So in a sense, providing bandwidth is easier. You just need more money to do that, right? Reducing latency is harder, in my opinion. Tolerating latency by taking advantage of more bandwidth is a good approach in general if you can do it. But reducing latency directly is usually harder. We can talk about that. This is more philosophical. But that's why, in my opinion, latency is a harder problem than bandwidth. Okay, should we wait for our thing to pass? I guess it's not as bad. Okay, reducing waste is important. Since this technology is not scaling really well, maybe we shouldn't be wasting it, right? And there's a lot of waste in DRAM, actually, today. You can think of like reducing that waste in different ways. Compression is a very good direction, in my opinion. But looking at deduplication is very interesting also. How do you actually find out? Let's say you have the value 8 stored in a billion locations in DRAM, but they're scattered all around. Can you somehow store one version of 8 and redirect the accesses, redirect the addresses to access that physical version? That's the idea of deduplication, right? It's different from compression. You can think of it as kind of similar, but it's really different. Basically, you store one copy of the deduplicated scattered thing, and you change the mapping function to actually access it once. But that's a very interesting direction also. I can recommend some papers related to that too. OK, I'll cover these directions, and maybe we'll take a break. As I talked about, this enabling computation close to data is really interesting too. These are some of the papers that my students have been writing in this area. And you can certainly pick from some of these papers to present. Some of these we've already covered. And some of these are related to avoiding the DRAM also by doing compression, for example, by doing better caching. So those are all important topics too. So you can, I'm giving you ideas on where to pick some of your papers potentially, but other papers are really interesting too, some of which we mentioned. So the second solution direction is looking at these emerging technologies. Promise is that some of these emerging technologies are resistive, and as a result, they're more scalable than DRAM. The problem with DRAM and flash is they're charge-based, right? They store charge in some charge storage unit. In DRAM, it's the capacitor. In flash memory, it's the floating gate, right? Floating gate transistor. And the problem with charges, it's difficult to place and control charge. You have, let's say, a few electrons. Charge, unfortunately, escapes. Right? That's the problem with retention. And in fact, retention is a problem with flash also. What do you guys think? Do you think flash chips need to be refreshed? No? It's non-volatile, right? But should we refresh them? It's a trick question. Jung was saying, yes, we should. That's the right answer, actually. Yes, we should. But it turns out, so flash, everybody thinks it's non-volatile, right? But it does lose charge. Its lifetime is, and I will recommend some papers related to that also. Let me actually do that. There are other papers, but I'll recommend Yukai's work, since he's done a lot of work in this area. Actually, maybe this is a good paper to read. Not this one. Let's do this one. Yeah. Error analysis and retention-aware error management for NAND flash memory. But it turns out flash lifetime is limited, right? Basically, in flash memory, you can do a write to a page. Basically, you can program a page. And you can do only a limited number of writes, limited number of programs to a page. Because what happens is, as you do program and erase and program and erase, what happens is that the cells wear out. And you have a limited number of write cycles or program erase cycles in flash memory. And today, in multi-level cell flash memory, that's in the order of 1,000 K or so, and 3,000 K or so. And it's reducing over time. Basically, you can write to a cell 3,000 times, let's say, and that's after that, the cell is dead. So it turns out the cell is dead because it cannot retain charge anymore toward the end of its lifetime, because it loses charge. Exactly, yes. That's the idea in some of these papers. So you can actually, what you can do is, initially, the cell is in perfect condition. It doesn't lose charge, at least as much. So when you buy flash, you don't refresh it for a while. But as the cell gets aged, basically, if you keep writing to it, and flash translation layer actually can count how many times you've written to a cell, over time, you start refreshing flash, refreshing the cells that have been aged. And that way, you can actually extend the lifetime of flash significantly. This was not very well known, by the way, 5 years ago or so. But now, it's very standard. I believe JEDEC actually recommends that all flash should be refreshed, such that you can extend its lifetime. That's pretty interesting, right? People thought, this is non-volatile memory. Don't refresh it. But unfortunately, you need to refresh it. it's not as bad as DRAM, because DRAM you need to refresh every 64 milliseconds, right? But flash, if you look at the paper, toward the end of the flash's lifetime, you refresh it every day, let's say. Every day is still bad in flash, because refresh takes long in flash. And the key question is, how do you do a refresh in flash, right? It's a slow memory. You can remap the data to some other place. That's one way of doing refresh. Actually, one of the solutions this paper proposes is in-place reprogramming. And I'll definitely recommend that you take a look at it. We should really talk about flash memory. Maybe someone can present things in flash memory sometime. There's actually an increasing body of literature in flash memory. If you're really interested in doing research in this area, this is a very, very hot area also, especially with the scaling problems flash is facing. But maybe some of you can do projects on it also. OK, let me actually find the thing that I was looking for. You can read the paper in detail, but OK, there it is. Yeah. That's the effect of energy overhead in refreshing flash. Basically, hybrid refresh means you do remapping sometimes, and you do in-place reprogramming sometimes. And if you refresh it every day, the energy overhead, basically, if you refresh flash every day, energy overhead is 5.5%, which is actually significant, right? 6% energy overhead. But then there's another question, right? Refreshing flash. Well, these things may be turned off, right? How do you refresh it without power? Yeah, that's right. Well, what about USBs, right? USB devices. They're turned off for years.
They're not expected to last.
I guess that's true, yeah. You can always make your specification bad or less stringent to solve the problem, I guess, yeah. It's not expected to last. Actually, one of the worst, the worst grade flash is used in those devices. So don't rely on those devices much. It's not enterprise grade. The worst possible grade is used in the flash devices. That's why everybody can give you those devices for free. But yeah, that's a challenge with a refresh, right? Okay, in DRAM you can do it because DRAM is supposed to be operational, right? Okay, let me talk about phase change memory very briefly, but it actually turns out it suffers from a similar problem, even though it's not charge-based. So phase change memory, basically, this is one example. It's expected to scale to 9 nanometer according to ITRS. And actually, this has gone down. It's expected to be denser than DRAM because you can store multiple bits per cell. In DRAM, actually, it's very difficult to store multiple bits per cell. But in phase change memory or flash, we already store multiple bits per cell, right? Because you can chop up the resistance range if your range is wide enough and detect the differences between multiple levels of resistance, right? Instead of detecting whether it's charged or discharged, as we do in DRAM, you detect the resistance level, or you detect the voltage level today in flash. That way you can store multiple bits per cell. In fact, today industry has 3-level cell flash, right? It's actually terrible from a wear out standpoint. I think the number of program erase cycles is on the order of hundreds. So a cell you can write to only 100 times, which is bad. But actually, some research direction in this area is actually understanding these new flash technologies and testing them and doing characterization and modeling them. So we actually have some FPGA boards that, if some of you are interested, that you can use to characterize flash and develop some solutions. I'm really interested in multi-level cell, like 3-level cell flash and 3D flash. Because actually, if you look at Samsung's presentation, I think it talks about 3D VNAND. Samsung calls it 3D VNAND. Basically, one of the ways of scaling flash into the future is doing 3D stacking. And that would be interesting to talk about at some point, too. But anyway, I keep digressing to flash for some reason, because it's really interesting, I think. Because the reason is DRAM and flash are technologies that exist today and that have been proven really well. These technologies are really interesting to examine, but that have not been proven, right? Flash, if you actually come up with a way of scaling flash into the future, you're guaranteed to have impact right away. These are a little bit difficult, although you may get lucky, right? You can actually come up with a new way of designing computers. That's the reward that you can get potentially in research here. The problem is with these technologies is they have shortcomings as well. They can scale really well, so they promise you very high capacity memory that is non-volatile. Unfortunately, they have shortcomings too. The key question is, can we somehow enable them to replace, augment, or maybe even surpass DRAM? And I think phase change memory is definitely interesting. There are other technologies, spin transfer torque, MRAM, that's really interesting. There's also memristors. So if somebody's interested in doing research and reading in this area, maybe we can have a session where they can present papers related to this. So OK, I was talking about refresh, but one of the issues with phase change memory, I said that charge escapes, but actually resistance drifts, apparently. Basically, you get the problem of resistance drift in phase change memory. Your resistance is not stable. It kind of moves a little bit. As a result, you cannot determine whether you have a 0 or 1 as easily. OK, so these are some of the papers that you may want to take a look at. And these are actually referenced from the paper that you read. So I think what this brings us to is you have these different solution directions. And maybe there is no single technology that's universal. People try to search universal memory technology that's good at every potential dimension, every potential metric. It turns out it's really difficult to get a memory technology like that. I think some people were advocating STT-MRAM that way as a universal technology, but it's going to be very difficult to sell that, in my opinion. In my opinion, universal memory technology doesn't exist. But that's my bias as a researcher. Maybe it does exist, right? Who knows? But this slide assumes that it's very difficult to get to it. So why don't we combine multiple different technologies off the same node in the same system that have different characteristics? DRAM, for example, fast and durable, but it has to be small because it's costly. And it's leaky and it's volatile. It has all these issues. And it may be less reliable. Or to make it reliable, you make it even more costly. Right? on the other hand, you may have some other technology, X, that's large, non-volatile, that's low cost, but it has some other downsides. It's slow, it wears out, it has high active energy, for example, in case of phase change memory, right? And the key question is, how do you actually design the entire system to do data allocation and movement in a way that's hardware-software cooperative, such that you can achieve the best of multiple of these technologies, right? And I think this is a really good direction also going forward. Maybe some of you can present papers related to this. And it doesn't need to be DRAM plus phase change memory. In fact, in my personal opinion, it's going to be less likely that it'll be DRAM plus phase change memory because of a lot of the issues with phase change memory that people have today. Maybe it is some DRAM that's really fast and the DRAM that's really slow, right? Maybe it's DRAM plus STT-MRAM, right? Maybe something else. So it's good to be more general in doing this kind of research. But it's a pretty exciting area. Okay, any questions, any thoughts? I think I've been talking too much in the last 20 minutes. I'm having less discussion.
I think Micron just withdrew their PCM in January this year.
That's true, yes. Partly, well, we don't know exactly what the reasoning may be internally, but it could be partly because of some of the technology issues with phase change memory, right? People are becoming less excited about phase change memory for that reason. I think there are other technologies that are interesting, like STT-MRAM. In fact, STT-MRAM is very interesting because it has this tight coupling between logic and memory. So you can do logic computation very close to memory, actually in the same memory cell. OK. Should we take a break, or should we just go until 12:20 and finish? What do you guys think? Who wants a break? OK, let's take a break for 5 minutes. And we'll cover two more slides maybe in the last 15 minutes. That we should really put up on the reading list is on 3D stacking. I definitely recommend this 3D stacked memory architectures for multi-core processors paper from ISCA 2008. It's a good tutorial on 3D stacked memory. It's relatively early, actually, in time. And there's actually an even earlier paper in Micro 2006. Called die stacking 3D microarchitecture. It's good to take a look at some of these papers. There are some new papers also. I'm not sure if this is a new paper, but I would encourage you, some of you, to look at this hybrid memory cube. I don't know if they have a good paper on this though. They have a Wikipedia entry. I don't know if that helps, depending on the correctness of it. Well, you can download the specification, right? You looked at this probably.
No, I looked at HBM.
Oh, okay. You didn't look at this? Maybe you should look at it.
Yeah. It has logic with DRAM, so it's
that's hard right. That's right, yes. Simulate. Yeah, Weikun has been looking at designing a flexible DRAM simulator such that you can actually model a lot of protocols. I guess this may be the next step at some point. That's right, yeah, there's nothing that's specified, right? Except for this specification, which probably doesn't tell anything about the logic side. Okay. Yeah, so this is one technology, for example, many companies have been members of. Let's look at the membership. Oh, we can be a member too, I guess. Not that I want to be, but about us, there you go. Yeah, basically, this is the memory and logic put together technology. They call it the hybrid memory cube. It's a fancy name. But this could be part of, this could be the DRAM that could actually be fast, high bandwidth, extremely energy intensive and efficient at the same time. It's energy efficient in the sense that